I see the King of Glory coming on the clouds with fire. The whole earth shakes, the whole earth shakes. I see His love and mercy washing over all our sin. The people sing, the people sing. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. I see a generation rising up to take their place with selfless faith, selfless faith. I see a near revival stirring as we pray and seek. We're on our knees, on our knees. Show me how to love like you have loved me. Break my heart for what breaks yours. Everything I am for your kingdom's cause. As I walk from earth into eternity. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the
Well, we know this is another week where Bob and Marsha are out of town for various reasons. I think they had a wedding and a funeral and just some other things that have kept them out for a couple of weeks. And this week, I have the honor of introducing my cousin, Josh, and his wife, Mary. Actually, technically, they're both my cousins. I claim them both. Yes. But so I've known Josh all his life. And yeah, I have a lot of stories I could tell, but since we're on camera, I will pass on some of that. And you'll learn more about their ministry. They, when God said, "Who will go for me?" they said, "Here am I, send me." And they've said it separately as singles out of college. And then they got married in 2017 and together are ministering as a couple. And I'll let you share more about that. And when we sang that second verse of the song, "I See a Generation Rising Up to Take Their Place," you know, we've had a lot in the world where we say, what's this next generation going to be looking like for us? And they're part of ministering to that college age where kids are out of school and independent for the first time, and they really are seeking, is this the faith that my parents instilled in me, or is this my own faith, or have I had no faith at all and just exposed to Jesus for the first time in a college setting? So I will let them share.
Thanks, Jen. Like she said, we're Josh and Mary Storie. Let's move down here one. You guys okay with this? We're going to get close and personal here. Like Jen said, thanks for that nice introduction, too. And everything I've heard about Jen here is like, oh, she's her cousin? She's awesome. We're so blessed to have her. And I'm like, yeah, we're blessed to have her as a cousin. So she invited us, I guess, a month and a half ago, said, hey, I live in the Florida Keys. You haven't been down to visit me. Why don't you come down to visit? We're just texting, you know. And yeah, that's a great question. And so with the university schedule this year, there's no spring break, actually. They're pushing right through. So that's a long story. Students are actually skipping class right now, and they're all at beaches right now anyways, doing their online classes. We took some days off to come down here. We're grateful to be here. This is Mary's first time in the Keys. This is my second time. So when I was in college, I took marine biology. So I was in Key Largo, did a snorkeling class for a week. And so I got a lot of good memories down here. Glad to be back. And so thanks again for having us. And we just want to share what we do, how the Lord has called us to where we're at. We're not giving a sermon this morning. We're not preaching. We're sharing about our ministry. And we're just evidence that the Lord can use just regular people just to do his work. So, and that's our hope for college students and our prayer, too, that they would go out into the world and through ministry in their workplace. So we've got some slides. Javi, I'm just going to kind of, yeah. So the first one, we're at the University of Tennessee, and we live in Knoxville, Tennessee. Mary's originally from Ohio. I'm from Middle Tennessee, so I married a Yankee, brought her down. She loves it. I'll let her tell you about that. And we just want to share about our ministry today. And so to start things off, we'll go to the next slide. And Mary's going to tell you a little bit about our history of our organization we work for.
Yeah, thanks. Also, I just want to note, I don't normally sing with my mask on. I know this may sound crazy, but sometimes I forget I'm wearing it. And so I realized halfway through the song, I was like, oh man, I look like a real dweeb right now. But I just forget it sometimes. I'm one of those, I guess. So yes, Crew. Crew has a really neat history. And so I think it's a really helpful place to start because what was true back in 1951 when it started is still remarkably true today. So the history of it. Here you see, that's Bill and Vonette Bright. And they were in Los Angeles and they came to faith. They became believers in Christ when they were later in life, like in their 30s. And it radically impacted them in a way that they owned a candy factory of all things, but they felt really compelled to kind of lay down their volition and their dreams in life and kind of just surrender it to the Lord. And so they did that. And as they did that, they just were kind of saying, okay, Lord, what do you want us to do? Where do you want us to go? And all of a sudden, UCLA kind of came into their like peripheral vision, and they realized what a unique like opportunity that could be for God's glory. They realized, like in the 50s, but it's still somewhat true today, college campuses are kind of a unique environment, and it's hard for the church to really gain much ground. And so they thought, that's a really unreached area that is right here before us. And they realized that if you can reach college students with the gospel after college, they're only there for four years, maybe some more. But, you know, they're there. And then they're going to go, and they're going to be lawyers, and they're going to be doctors and teachers and nurses and moms and dads and stuff like that. So they're going to be sent all over. They can take the gospel to many places. So they saw this incredible strategy. Their kind of tagline when the ministry started was, if you can reach the campus today, you can reach the world tomorrow. And that is still so true, which we love. So if you want to go to the next slide, Javi. So it started just as one ministry at UCLA, and now Crew has grown with the same kind of vision that that they would go where the gospel isn't necessarily going. And so if you want to go to the next one, over the last 70 years, it's our 70th anniversary this year, Crew has kind of spread into all these different ministries. The main one is still the campus ministry, but you'll see all sorts of, maybe you even recognize some of them. The Josh McDowell ministry, that's a really neat evangelistic ministry. The Jesus film as well, it's the Gospel of Luke that they've put into movie format. And it's actually been shared, or it's been translated into almost 2,000 different languages, different like local tribal dialects. And it's been viewed since 1976, I think, 79, thank you, babe, 8 billion times. So it's a really, really powerful, effective tool. And I could tell you about all of them, but you'd get bored really fast. Not because they're boring, I'm boring. So anyways, that is just the history of Crew, but still that hope is that the world would be reached. And so even today, maybe even right now, there are college students reaching other college students with the gospel in all over the world, China, Jamaica, everywhere you can think of. Crew has a presence in more countries than McDonald's, which is kind of crazy. So that's just a little bit of our history, and we'll tell you a little bit about what that looks like in today's culture. So I'll give this over to Josh.
So if you can go to the next slide. Yeah, so and most of these pictures we're using are actually, the one before wasn't, but most of these are actually from the campus we work at, the University of Tennessee. So these are actual real pictures, not staged pictures. There is tremendous competition for the minds and hearts of students. Go to the next slide, please. Students today, they face tons of challenges. I guess y'all have probably heard stories of college professors, you know, students going into the classroom, growing up in Christian families, you know, going in. Here's an actual quote from University of Central Florida. A professor said, "For the Christians in my class who argued the validity of Christianity, I suppose I should thank you for demonstrating to the rest of the class what religious arrogance and bigotry looks like." So I've heard stories like this personally. This is at University of Central Florida, UCF, but it kind of hits close to home, you know. This is happening in East Tennessee where we're at in Knoxville. I hear students weekly telling me stories of, "Well, I really believe this. I'm almost tempted to write my paper like this just to please my professor because I know he's going to give me, he or she's going to give me a bad grade." And so it just, college is just, I guess it's a time where they're hearing kind of the progressive voices from professors and the influence in their life. And it's almost scary, the spiritual warfare that they're facing. If you can go to the next slide. But God. So we're studying Ephesians this semester in our Crew ministry at UT. And, you know, there's this part in Ephesians 2, you know, he's explaining, like, you were dead in sin, you know, all these things, like following the prince of the power of the air. And then there's this phrase, but God, here's the good news. So here's the good news with us. But God, in the face of these competitive forces, God is bringing an increasing number of students into relationship with himself. These are some of our guys at a retreat here. So the next slide. We're trusting God to reach the 150 million college students of the world, not just UT, with the message of Christ. Each student, every campus. So Crew is a huge organization, like Mary was saying. This picture, I know it's a little small on the slide. There are, 28,000 students at the University of Tennessee. And this picture was just a sea of freshmen. This is a year and a half ago before COVID, before the pandemic. And so just, you see orange everywhere. And by the way, I want to say, if there's any Florida fans or anybody else, like SEC, like ignore the T on my shirt. Think about the students' lives maybe and just get past football and basketball. We're out of the tournament already. So if that's any kind of distraction this morning, I just want to say that. So just think about students, you know, during that, like, what were you like when you were 18 to 22, you know? So next slide. And so our strategy with Crew, with Campus Crusade for Christ, is threefold: to win students to Christ, W-I-N, to build them up in their faith, and send them out into the world. So winning students to Christ, this can look different in lots of different ways. And some of the ways we do that is just we meet students one-on-one in the student union before COVID, and they're sitting down eating their Chick-fil-A. We approach them, we talk to them, we try to share the gospel with them if we can. There's all kinds of digital outreaches now. Students are, they want to text with apps called Snapchat, like where the text will disappear. I'm like, what did you just say to me? It's crazy, this generation. And so let me tell you about a student named Will that I met. So before we were at UT, University of Tennessee, we were working in Johnson City, Tennessee at East Tennessee State University. And we were in the student union. There's a student sitting by himself. His name's Will. And me and another guy approached him and said, hey, we're with a campus ministry here. We'd like to talk to you about life and spiritual things. Can we join you? We just flat up asked him. And he's like, takes out his headphones. You know, students always have headphones, whether they're listening to something or not. It's just they're trying to ignore society, you know, and be in the zone and not wave at you. And he took his headphones out. He said, sure. And he had his Chick-fil-A there. And we began talking to him and hearing about his life story. And he opened up so much, even in the first 5 minutes, and said, you guys are the first people to talk to me here. I'm a commuter. I'm a freshman. I don't know anybody. And like what's that?
It was in January, too.
Yeah, so second semester. Didn't know anybody. And he's sitting there eating his Chick-fil-A. I think he'd taken one bite of a sandwich. And then an hour and a half later, maybe two bites, where we were saying, Will, it's okay. You can eat while we talk. You know, he's so nervous and just so introverted. And I said, Will, it's great hearing your story, man. Would you like to come to our weekly meeting? We have a weekly meeting with crew every week. And he came. He showed up, not knowing anybody. Again, here's this commuter. He's making the effort to drive 20 minutes to campus on a night where he doesn't have classes and come to our meeting. Soon after that, Will joined my Bible study. I was leading a freshman guy's Bible study, and he's faithful every week. And now, was he a junior? He's a senior this year. He's about to graduate, and he's still very involved in the ministry. He has tons of friends. He has a good Christian community that he did not have. And so it's so cool to see someone like Will, you know, who went from knowing nobody to having this family, you know. And Mary's going to share about another student.
Yeah, another example of winning someone to Christ is a guy named Travis that we actually just met last semester. It's been such a unique year with COVID. I think, honestly, we came into things in August thinking, you know, maybe at worst we'll just have a prayer ministry and we'll just pray a whole lot all semester. Maybe that's the best we'll get to do. And I think I was okay with that. You know, that'll be maybe a little boring, but we'll take it, Lord. But God has been so gracious. At UT, there was even a time when cases were really picking up around, right before like Christmas break, where the only groups that were allowed to gather on campus, granted you had to gather outside, but only worship groups were allowed to meet. And that is just incredible. We were shocked that God would give us favor in that way on a secular campus. It's kind of crazy. So anyways, so last fall, we've realized students need community. They not only like, yes, coming to a meeting is great, but they can just slip on out and they really are longing for connection with their peers and spiritual connection. So that's kind of the hope of our meeting, that it would be a place where students could come and meet their peers and make some friends, because it's really their only opportunity. They don't talk to people in class because they're in Zoom and they can't really go into other people's dorm rooms. Like, it's so lonely on campus. So we did a trivia night after our crew meeting to give people a chance to just build some more relationships, make some more connections, give them some fun too. Like, I think fun is kind of few and far between this year. So we had a trivia night, and this guy named Travis came, and he came just for trivia, but as we started talking to him, we realized that Travis had grown up in a Christian home, but college had really thrown him for a loop, which it does a lot of students. It's a cool time that maybe students who haven't grown up from a spiritual background are kind of presented with this chance to ask a whole lot of questions and figure out what they think. I mean, students are figuring out anything from like do I want to wear deodorant? To like, is God real? It's like a crazy spectrum of things that they're trying to discern and figure out. So Travis showed up and we realized he just had a lot of questions and he had kind of meandered away from the faith. He's a junior. And so he came and as we talked, we realized there was a deep spiritual yearning within him. So the next week, Josh was able to meet with him and it's just been incredible. I think Travis hadn't found Christian community where he could really plug in and be known. And so to see his life change just in the last 6 months, Travis is one of those people, he's so fun. He feels like a gift to us from the Lord because he is such a catchy personality. Kind of charismatic. And so he brings people with him every week. He brings somebody new to crew. And he is even to the point where he wants to go to China for a year after college and just do ministry. And so it's pretty neat, the trajectory shift of his life. It's been quite a 180. And it's been really neat just to see the way that he now is influencing others and hoping to win people to Christ himself. So those are just two of some of our favorite stories. It's one of my favorite parts of our job. I'm not going to lie, when I first started working for crew, I thought it was kind of weird that we just walk up to strangers. I thought that maybe that worked in the 70s, but surely it won't work now. And every year I'm like, man, maybe this is the year when students are going to be like, please leave me alone. But year after year, student after student, these students want to talk. They have questions. They are curious. And maybe they've been hurt by the church, and so they just need someone that is willing to listen and say, I'm sorry, that does not represent Jesus. So it's really a fun part of our job, and it really doesn't get old. I'm continually amazed, but we just love it. So, now Josh is going to tell you about the second part of our threefold ministry, Build, if you want to go to the next slide.
Yeah, so even going back to the last slide, it can be weird to approach a total stranger, you know. And like I said earlier, we do digital outreaches, and we do these tables at the beginning of the school year, you know, and they fill out forms, they're winning AirPods, things like that. We meet up with them for spiritual conversations, and something we try to do when we meet with students is share the gospel with them. Many students have grown up in church, especially in East Tennessee and the Bible Belt. Like, there's like 21 churches like within like 10 miles, you know, if you travel across town. So most students have grown up in church, but a lot of them have never heard God loves them. God has a wonderful plan for their life, you know. We're sinful. We're separated from God. Therefore, we need a Savior. We need Jesus. He's the only answer to save us from our sins. So we must individually put our faith and trust in Him. He alone can save us. And so we have those conversations. We try to get right to the gospel with students. And another way we do that is through building them up in their faith. So small group Bible studies, one-on-one mentor, we call it discipleship. The Great Commission says, go and make disciples of all nations. And so we're making disciples right at our home, you know, and that's what we long for students to do too, wherever they are when they graduate, to make disciples, even if they don't go, even if they stay, to the key word, to make disciples. And so what our weeks look like, in case you're wondering, we meet students in coffee shops, we meet them in the student union when there's chairs and tables set up. This has been a weird year. I mean, I don't even have to tell you guys that. You know that. There's, like, the auditoriums on campus, the seats are zip-tied shut. Like, the room we meet in usually holds, like, 300 or 400 students. I think we can have, what is it, like, 58? Like, the magic number of seats that aren't zip-tied. And so we've got conferences and retreats, summer missions. My wife and I actually met in Clearwater Beach, Florida on a crew summer mission. So Florida is a very special place to us. And so these students are leaving for the summer. They're getting jobs in places like that, Gatlinburg, Tennessee, Clearwater, Florida, then go across the world. A lot of the students are experiencing, like I think I said earlier, like the family of God, like a spiritual community, brothers and sisters in Christ, like a lot of them for the first time. And to when you live in that community and other people, you have other people praying for you, supporting you, working alongside you. It's a very special thing. And so it's so cool to see students go on our summer missions and come back. And they're like, yes, I get it. I want to tell my coworkers about Christ. I want to graduate and, you know, I want to have a Bible study. You know, I want to be sent out from this place, you know. Whether or not I'm doing full-time ministry, like, I can do this anywhere in my workforce. And so we have, what else we got, Mary? We got a big winter conference every year. Like, there's tons of things. Like, we stay up late with our job. So we're visiting Jen. She's like, I go to bed early. You know, I'm a nurse, and I get up early and doing this. And we're like, well, we stay up till at least midnight every night and sleep in. You know, our hours are so different. So much of our evenings are hanging out with students. We have Bible studies that we both lead. We're allowed to have Bible studies on campus. I'm still blown away sometimes when, like, the privileges and the opportunities that we have on a secular university campus and the things we can do. I mean, even, like, our weekly meeting, like, we're allowed to meet because worship is involved. And, like, well, yeah, we're doing that. We're worshiping the Lord, you know. Like, that's awesome. So there's all these other clubs and student organizations that can't meet this year. But we've been given favor, and that's just really God's grace to us. If you want to go to the next slide.
Yeah, so one of my favorite examples of build that really just happened within the last few weeks, I think I'd take for granted what a gift it is to be, like, worshiping alongside your peers as a college student, how countercultural that may feel. And so there's these four girls that all went to high school together. They're commuters. They're from Knoxville. And they showed up at our weekly meeting that kind of at the end of January. And I kind of caught them right as they were leaving. And I said, hey, is this your first time? I'd love to meet y'all. And they started telling me about themselves. And I said, you know, I so admire as a commuter that you would come late at night to campus just to worship with us. I know that takes a lot of effort and it'd be easy to stay home. So thanks for coming. And they said, yeah, we loved it. This was awesome. And I said, well, I lead a Bible study. It's on Tuesday nights. So I was like, I totally understand if you don't want to drive to campus at night, another night. But know that it's there and you'd be so welcome to join us. And they said, yeah, maybe we'll think about it. And then ironically, the next week in Ephesians, we were studying the second half of Ephesians 2, which talks about community and unity. And they all, like, ran down to me and they're like, Mary, we feel so convicted. We're going to come to Bible study next week. And I said, okay, great. I said, just come check it out. I get it. If it's like, you don't feel like it's worth it, then that's fine. I won't be offended. But they came, and they're still coming, which is awesome. But the thing that has really stuck out to me that, like I said, I take for granted, they said, it is incredible. They said, we've never seen people our own age that want to walk with Jesus like this. This is incredible. Like, we didn't know there were people like this at UT that wanted to do this. And so I think it's just, like we said, we just forget how cool and special it can be to students to, like, look around, you know, to the left and the right and be like, I'm not the only one that cares about this and is kind of different. So it's a pretty neat thing, kind of like not Ephesians, but when Paul talks about running the race, it's like they're running this race together, and it's really powerful. Something about doing it alongside your peers is really incredible. And that's our hope, is that, you know, as students are built up and they grow in their love for the Lord and their zeal, that it would just kind of pour out of them. It'd be like kind of second nature to just want to talk about it. And so that's the beauty of Build. We just want to give students an opportunity, like this says, to be equipped to walk with Jesus for the rest of their lives and to invest spiritually in the lives of those around them. So short-term mission trips are a wonderful way to do that. But then we realize, though, of, like, all the students involved in our ministry, maybe one in every 10 will end up doing some kind of full-time ministry. So we really want students to not necessarily go into ministry. I mean, we're not mad about it if they do, but, you know, we realize they're going to go, like I said, to be lawyers, doctors, nurses, all these things. So we want them to be equipped to walk with Jesus for the rest of their lives. If we didn't, you know, strategize our ministry like that, it'd just kind of, like, fall off and fall short and be a waste of everybody's time and money. So it's neat to see that kind of long-term trajectory in a couple students. And so if you want to go to the next slide, Javier, these are two students who we're involved with crew, and the girl up there in the corner, that's Carson. She actually just graduated this fall, and she's still around. I think she wanted to graduate early because it sounded really impressive and cool, and now she's like, I don't know what to do with myself. But she's going to law school in the fall, and so she's been amazing. She and I have co-led our Bible study together on Tuesday nights, and she just has such a heart for people, and she has a heart to be an influencer and to change. And so that's why she wants to go into law. She wants to be used by God to impact his world for good. And so she's just one of those examples of someone who is truly going to go and be a light wherever she goes. And it's exciting to think about. And then do you want to talk about Josh?
Sure. Okay. Yeah, this is Josh, the other picture. Not me, Josh. Josh M, we'll call him here on camera. He was one of our students this past year, too. He graduated right before COVID and considered doing full-time ministry. The Lord led him to do business, and he's in Chattanooga, Tennessee right now, doing a business job, and he's just really thriving in his place there. So we picked these students. These are model students that were just, it's awesome to see the Lord use their college years and then to be sent out from the university and to keep living for Christ. So if you want to go to the next slide. So this slide says, we invite people to partner with us to reach UT students and students all around the world for Christ. There's a picture of me and Mary. We'll say that's our dog. We don't have any pets, so that's Smokey. You can go to the next one. And we would love if y'all would like to keep up with us, to receive our newsletter. It's really small on the screen, but this is our email addresses that we have. If you would like to receive our newsletters, and Mary's actually got a journal up here too for afterwards. If you can't read that, if you want to say, hey, here's my email, we'll write it down here or let you write it down. But every month or every few months, depending on what kind of updates we have, this is just a sample of a newsletter that we send out to different churches and individuals, and just to partner with us, to pray for us. We couldn't do this without the help of others in those ways. And so just a way for you guys to stay connected. Like I said, you might not have a heart for the University of Tennessee, especially being down in the Florida Keys, but I pray that you would have a heart for college students around the world, you know, no matter what university or college they go to. And so this is just a way that y'all can partner with us. But we're just going to wrap this up. And we just want to say, again, thanks so much for even giving us the privilege to share just a little bit about our ministry. We could talk all day. We have stories like overseas and just Ohio, Tennessee, different campuses. It's just what ministry looks like at different places. And we really see ourselves doing this indefinitely until the Lord calls us somewhere else. You know, who knows? We don't know. A day at a time, right? And we enjoy meeting with students as long as they enjoy still meeting with us, you know, and we still tell them to take their headphones out and talk to us, you know. And so we would appreciate your prayers, and we'll pray for you guys too as a church. Thanks so much for letting us be here. This is a really neat opportunity for us, just in the Florida Keys, in a historical church with all of you, probably from lots of different places also. So thanks again.
We're actually going to lead you in our closing song, Oh How He Loves You and Me. Josh is going to play the guitar. So you've heard some stories from the stories. Mm-hmm. They use that family name, a lot of puns we have going on. His older brother, Jason, is actually with crew also in Eastern Kentucky University. So it's a family ministry for them right now. So.
He loves you and me.
You guys can sing with us.
Oh, how he loves you and me. He gave his life. What more could he give? Oh, how he loves you.
you'll stand with me on the second verse.
Jesus to Calvary did go. His love for sinners to show. What he did there brought hope from despair. Oh, how he loves you. Oh, how he loves me. Oh, how he loves you.
Have a good afternoon. I'm going to close this in prayer. Lord, we thank you for the ministry that you have called Josh and Mary to. Lord, we pray that you would place the prayer of college students on the hearts today, that we would have a burden for the next generation coming. We see what's going on in our own lives as adults, and we know how much harder that's going to be for the next round coming in this world, in this life, in this country. So, Lord, I pray that you would just place special prayer on our hearts for them and for those ministering to those college students. God, you've brought each person into this room today for a special reason. Lay on our hearts what you have in store for us as we go into our week and the people we come in contact with in our jobs and in our communities. Lord, I pray that we would just take this out, make our faith conversational, make our faith something so obvious that people have to ask us about it. Lord, bless our day, bless our week, and in Jesus' name, amen.